Welcome to part one of our Dying Light to Stay Human Developer Tools Guide. In this video, we'll show you how to start your own project and navigate the user interface. Let's start from scratch. First, we'll click Create New Project on the Developer Tools main dashboard. Be sure to choose a name. Check off Use Example Map to utilize it as a base for the purposes of this tutorial. We can also use example maps if you're in need of references. Now, let's click OK and wait for Developer Tools to create our first project. Now that we have a fully loaded example map, right away you'll see that the largest part of the editor is the map overview window. To look around, hold down the right mouse button and move the mouse. Use the scroll wheel to zoom in and out. Hold the Shift button on your keyboard to speed up the zoom motion or hold Alt to slow it down. To pan the camera view, click and hold down the wheel and move the mouse. Likewise, we can use the up and down arrow keys on your keyboard to zoom in or zoom out, and the right and left arrow keys to do the pan. Remember, hold Shift to speed it up or hold Alt if you want to slow down for more precision. By combining these moves, you can easily and freely move around the map and fly to spots where you want to edit or add new objects. Alright, now that you know the camera movements, let's take a look at the user interface. Under the Window tab, you'll find a vast array of additional tools that are normally hidden in the editor. The toolbar is just under the menu bar. Here you'll find all the essential tools you might need to create your own project. The first tool icon allows you to create a completely new map. The second one lets you open already existing projects, while the third acts as a way to save our current progress. The following tools help you transform and edit objects, which we'll talk about more in the next part. Now, let's zoom in on this car rag as an example, selected by simply clicking on it. Use the crossed out eye icon to hide selected objects. To unhide, press the regular eye that's right next to it. Let's select the object once more and choose the tiny triangle next to the crossed out eye to see additional hide tools. In this instance, you can hide everything apart from this car. To bring everything back, simply press the regular eye tool. The unhide icon works similarly in that it has a tiny triangle that opens up a flyout menu with additional tools of its own. To deselect objects, press Escape on your keyboard. Let's move on to the next tool. The sliders icon is used for filtering objects on the map. You can press the slider symbol to enable all filters. Just like that, you'll see that we have gray boxes, pink circles, and some other new elements scattered around the map. By pressing the triangle icon on filters for additional tools, you can filter specific groups of objects by clicking on the icons right next to their names. For example, let's say we don't want to see the gray boxes. As you hover your mouse over boxes, you will notice that it says they're visible. When you press the two connected squares once, the gray boxes disappear only when selected. By clicking it a second time, it will stay invisible at all times. Now that you know this, let's bring them back. You can also use filters to hide or unhide some rendering features. Let's take the flying trash in the air that can be spotted in my current position. To hide it, let's go back to the Additional Filters Tools menu and uncheck Weather Effects. As you can see, they're gone, no longer blowing in the wind. Remember that this change will only work for some parts of the editor. Whenever we play the game, the flying weather effects will still appear. The good thing about this option is that you can uncheck the sliders icon to hide all helpers. Note that this action will hide every single filter, including the floating trash effects, which you can easily work without. If you find the trashy aesthetic essential to your workflow, check off those weather effects. Now, let's move on to how we can undo certain actions. Let's say we hit this car by accident and we want to bring it back. I could always use the hide or unhide icon, but there is a quicker alternative that also works in other instances whenever we mess up. Go to Viewport and press the back arrow icon to undo. To redo the action we've just undone, press redo. You can also use shortcuts on your keyboard. Control Z for undo and Control Y for redo. As you can see, it's fairly easy to bring back something you moved or deleted by accident. The next important toolbar is in the viewport. We can find it just below the map name in the viewport with four distinct categories. The first one, View, can be used to edit your field of view. go to Par Amps to open camera settings. Change vertical FOV to 25. The field of view changed quite a bit. If we set it to 100, that field of view will be wider. To go back, we can change the value to what we had before. The next neat option is the so-called rendering distance. In this view, we can pretty much see everything on the map. Now, let's suppose you just want to see a smaller part of it. In that case, return to view, params, and change the far value to 50. With that, the rendering distance on my map has shrunk significantly. So to make it larger like before, we need to go through the motions. So params and in far, change it to a higher number. For now, let's go with 1000. Changing the rendering distance to a smaller one helps us focus on a specific region of the map without loading up all of it. It helps a lot with performance, especially when you have a pretty big map. Yet, another nice option in the view toolbar is the view settings. Here you can edit margins, of course, but also aspect ratios. For example, you want to see the game from the player's perspective. Input the 16:9 aspect ratio and finalize click OK. So far, nothing has changed. That is until you go to View and check Apply View Settings. Now, the viewport is changed to 16:9. You can use this to preview things like cutscenes. Our second option is Location. Let's say we're searching for a good spot for our cutscenes. If you want to check out different locations but save the one we're currently on, click on Location, Store, and finally Location 1. That will save the location of the current camera position. Maybe we really like this spot here. Go to Location, Store, and Location 2. If you want to return to Location 1, find Location, apply, and press Location 1. Now, the third main option controls how you see things in your viewport. Click View Presets and switch to Editor. Nothing in our viewport has changed because we are already working on the Editor preset, meaning there is no color grading scheme that you would normally see in the game. In order to have the color grading that our players would normally see in this location, go to View Presets and switch to Normal. Hopefully, you can see how the overall appearance of the scene has changed to be more like the in-game image. And the last, but equally important option within the viewport toolbar is the environment. Here, you can change the time of the day and preview how our maps change with it. Not to mention, you can also alter the weather. Feel free to play around and test out how the lights hit your map at various hours or during different atmospheric conditions. And that's all for part 1. In the next video, we'll talk about transform tools and how to add new objects to the map. Thanks for watching.